What is good, everybody? Welcome back to another My Damn Toys video. Tonight we got the SummerSlam 2018 full show review. So I guess we can start things off with the pre-show, guys. We'll just knock it all out at once right here. We had three matchups. The first one was the mixed tag match between Rusev and Lana taking on Almas and Vega. Very underwhelming match, in my opinion. Sort of a botched ending when Vega rolled up Lana for the victory. This match was pretty much nothing. I mean, it belonged on the pre-show for as long as it went. It was very short, not as long as I expected it to go. Very underwhelming for Rusev and Almas. Next, we have my boy Cedric Alexander taking on Gulak in a Cruiserweight Championship match. I enjoyed this match a lot. It wasn't anything insane, but it was an enjoyable matchup, even though it was on the pre-show. I wish these guys could open a show or something, because, you know, the pre-show over and over and over again is just, you know, terrible. I want them guys to get on the main card, but the last 5 to 6 minutes of this thing was great. Cedric did retain, thank God, and the second matchup of the pre-show also ended on a roll-up, so two roll-ups. And then the third one was the Raw Tag Team title match between the B-Team and the Revival. The B-Team did retain, and this match was pretty much pointless, pretty much just a waste of a match. And the Revival pretty much looked worthless, and it ended on, you guessed it, a roll-up. So just a mega pack of fruit roll-ups on the pre-show. So the main show kicked off with the Intercontinental Championship match between Seth Rollins and Dolph Ziggler, the rematch from Extreme Rules. Dean Ambrose in the corner of Seth Rollins, Drew McIntyre in the corner of Dolph Ziggler, and guys, they did an absolutely fantastic job in this match, much better than Extreme Rules. You see what happens when the crowd doesn't hijack the match. I enjoyed this match to death. Perfect way to kick off the show. You know, two great performers, two great in-ring workers, and I love this match to death. My boy Dolph Ziggler, though, did lose his Intercontinental Championship, and the Kingslayer, the Architect, the Man, and I guess you can call him Thanos now, because he won back his white and gold Intercontinental Championship, and his gear looks sick AF, guys. You can expect a custom coming very soon. I'm going to get working on that as soon as possible, and we're going to have a Seth Rollins Thanos custom elite figure. But I love this match to death. Again, a great way to kick off the show. And the end of it came when Drew McIntyre got up on the ring apron, distracted Seth Rollins. Dean Ambrose would yank him off, hit him with the dirty deeds. Seth Rollins turned around, not paying attention to Ziggler. Ziggler goes for the super kick. He would whiff. Seth Rollins would hit a super kick, hit the curb stomp. 1, 2, 3. Crowd was on fire. Great way to start the show. And Seth Rollins wins back the Intercontinental Championship. And I continue to see these two teams are going to go head-to-head continuing on. And then, bro, they totally teased that Dean Ambrose heel turn. Did you see the way he's walking around that ring? He will turn heel eventually, guys. Next up, we have the SmackDown Live Tag Team Championship match between the Bludgeon Brothers and the New Day. Hey guys, and I had to kick myself for a second because I thought I was dreaming. Did I see two consecutive matches on a WWE pay-per-view where I didn't want to cut my eyeballs out? My God, this match was great as well. I mean, you have two great teams. The best match that the Bludgeon Brothers have put on since, you know, changing gimmicks and becoming the Bludgeon Brothers. I think that both teams showcased their true talents in this matchup. I thought that, you know, the New Day, they always look great. Xavier Woods, criminally underrated. Every single time he steps in the ring, he proves why he belongs in the New Day and why, you know, a lot of people write him off as the worst member. I think that he tears it down every time. Big E looked great. Kofi, you know, he didn't do anything, but he did get involved a little bit. The Bludgeon Brothers and the New Day just tore it up right here. I enjoyed this match a lot. And then the ending, my God, why'd they have to end this way, guys? The ending came when Xavier Woods was gonna, you know, jump off for an up-up, down-down to win the matchup. Big E had Harper up on his shoulder like the big ending, but they were going for the up-up, down-down. Eric Rowan comes in with the hammer and hits Xavier Woods, causing disqualification. And it's like, Jesus Christ, why you gotta ruin a great matchup with that ending? I know it was to build heat. That's the exact reason why they did it, you know, build up more heat. And I can see this building up, and then we're gonna get a Hell in a Cell match between the two teams, which will be epic, like the Usos versus the New Day. And the New Day, I just love them, guys. I mean, they just prove every week and every match they're in that they belong in the title picture. It's just, I know that it gets annoying seeing them, but they truly belong there. Great in the mic, great in the ring. They always put on great matches, and this was no disappointment besides the finish. So the Bludgeon Brothers do retain their SmackDown Live tag titles after getting themselves disqualified, but the New Day did technically win the matchup. Well, next up, ladies and gentlemen, we had this disappointing AF piece of trash match between Braun Strowman and Kevin Owens. Of course, the Money in the Bank briefcase of Braun Strowman's was on the line. You know, Kevin Owens wins. He gets the Money in the Bank contract. Yeah. Got destroyed, ladies and gentlemen. Didn't even have a chance. They just buried my boy Kevin Owens. They just destroyed Kevin Owens. Didn't even get a chance, man. He comes out. He gets beat up, gets slammed into the corner, onto the outside, gets, you know, the runaround spot. Braun Strowman runs around the ring, hits him. He does a backflip, does it again, does a backflip, takes him over to the stage, choke slams him forever onto the steel on the ramp, throws him back in the ring, power slam, one, two, three, that's it. My God, it lasted like 4 minutes. What a just big, huge waste. I feel like that is just tough. Like, he didn't have to win. You know, Kevin Owens did have to win the match, but my God, they legit buried him. They made him look like trash. There is, like, I don't even know what to say. I was so disappointed with this outcome. Like, I wanted Kevin Owens to win so bad, but at the same time, I did not expect them to bury him. He was buried. That is a legit burial. That was worse than Taker versus Cena. This was a straight-up burial. And I was highly upset with this outcome. I did not expect that at all. I thought, you know, whatever. But it just goes to show, WWE made this matchup just to have people to talk, guys. They did not have even a thought of giving Kevin Owens this briefcase. And that upsets me. You know, KO is looking fresh. KO in the bank. I'll probably get a custom of it. Even though I don't want to remember this atrocity, I'm still going to get the custom. But, yeah, it's very disappointing. Braun Strowman retains his briefcase, and Kevin Owens gets buried. Next up, ladies and gentlemen, we had the SmackDown Live Women's Championship match. It was a triple threat match between Becky Lynch, Charlotte, and Carmella. And I didn't have high expectations for this matchup, considering Carmella's absolutely awful. But Charlotte and Becky Lynch are two of my favorite workers. You know, Becky Lynch, my favorite woman on the roster, and they're killing it. They had some great moments in this matchup. Definitely Carmella's, you know, best match since being champion, hands down. But to be fair, she was with two of the best workers, like I said, in the entire WWE. So you can't really, you know, fault it at all. And this match would have been a lot better, but I feel like they botched a few times. There's some parts in this matchup that could have been a lot cleaner. However, for the most part, I did enjoy this match. I found myself enjoying it. And Becky Lynch locks in to disarm her. Carmella crawls to the ropes, locks in the rope. So there is a rope break. She hits her with a Bexploder, locks in to disarm her again. And then Charlotte would hit the natural selection on Becky Lynch. One, two, three. Charlotte Flair, new SmackDown Live Women's Champion. And I would be upset about this, but I know where they're going with it. And I am very excited. But Charlotte wins the championship, and you know what? It's like everything works out perfectly in storyline, because I'll go ahead and tell you, Becky Lynch after the match turns heel on Charlotte Flair. You know, they embrace, they hug, and Becky Lynch starts beating the tar out of Charlotte Flair, and it's like, hell yes, guys, because, you know, Charlotte's been on TV for 3 months, and then, you know, Becky's been busting her ass, gets this opportunity. Charlotte comes back, doesn't do anything, gets just thrown into this championship match, and wins the championship. And it's like, no, bro, that's my title. So she kicks the shit out of Charlotte. She's like, no, bro, that's my championship. You don't deserve this. And I think that's beautiful storytelling right there. I enjoyed this match, and I was pretty satisfied with the outcome, and I'm so happy to see what Becky Lynch does as a heel. Next, ladies and gentlemen, we have the WWE Championship match between the phenomenal AJ Styles taking on Samoa Joe. Samoa Joe rocking the royal blue and black shorts, and AJ broke out the freaking phenomenal perp on him, guys. Looking great. Make a custom of that or not. I don't know if I will. It just depends if I want to use one of my leftover styles. It could possibly happen. Let me know down in the comment section below if I should make the AJ Styles. But this match was great. I love the storytelling, guys. That was the biggest part of this match. The storytelling in this was excellent. I loved it. You know, the match itself was pretty good. Like, I enjoyed it. There were some slow moments, but for the most part, I did enjoy the crap out of this match. You know, for the most part, it was a slow burn storytelling match, and this is not the end of this feud. They're going to go to Hell in a Cell and have a Hell in a Cell match, and it's going to be even better. You know, Joe made it personal before the match. He introduced AJ Styles' wife, and then during the match, he said, you know, I said AJ wasn't going to come, or your daddy wasn't coming home. I'll be your daddy. and, you know, making it really personal. AJ snapped, had his head busted open, attacked Samoa Joe with a steel chair, ending it in a disqualification, and I'm fine with that. I thought, you know, the build for this is perfect. You know, they didn't have long enough to make it too personal, but now it's at a level where, you know what I'm saying, the longevity of this thing could be great. I cannot wait till Hell in a Cell. I think these guys are going to have a great Hell in a Cell match, and I appreciated this match. AJ Styles does lose by disqualification, so technically Samoa Joe does win, but AJ Styles retained his WWE Championship in a good one. Next up, we cut to the stage, and we have Elias doing a live concert. You know, he mocks the crowd like he always does some smart comments, talking about doing his best song ever, and as he goes to play the guitar, the neck snaps in half on the guitar right there, guys, and Elias kicks his stool over, goes, you know, ballistic and trashes everything and walks off stage. Next up, guys, we had The Miz taking on Daniel Bryan in this somewhat grudge match, you know, been building for the last 8 years. Great storytelling in this matchup. Not my favorite match, you know. I thought it was going to be better than it was, but they gave it longevity, which I liked. A bit slow at times, but I did enjoy the matchup. Daniel Bryan would end up losing to The Miz. Maurice was sitting front row, and she snuck The Miz, like, near the end of the matchup, she snuck The Miz some brass knuckles, and the ref did not see it. Miz put on the brass knucks, hit Daniel Bryan in the head, and 1, 2, 3, that's over. I figured this, I predicted The Miz to win, just because this is not the end of the storyline. I think they'll have maybe another match, and then we'll have one more match later on down the road to culminate this feud. But The Miz did win in a solid little matchup, and it was good storytelling. Just like AJ and Joe, this had a lot of great storytelling in it, and I enjoyed it. But yes, The Miz does defeat Daniel Bryan, but this feud is clearly not over. Our next matchup was Constable Trash Constipated Awful Corbin taking on Oh, wait a second. The demon shows up, ladies and gentlemen. The demon did... I knew this was going to happen after, you know, the match had been put off. It wasn't, you know, close to the opening. I was like, you know, we're running out of time on this show, and I think the demon will come out and squash Constable, whatever the crap you want to call him, Corbin. And that's exactly what happened. You know what I'm saying? Bam. Coup de grace. Finn Balor brings the demon back, thank God. We haven't seen him since TLC last year, guys, so this was an epic little surprise. The demon paint looks so slick. One of many attires that just looks so great tonight. The demon was looking freaking amazing. So glad to see him back. Now, hopefully they, you know, bring him out at Survivor Series. Bring him out. Like, have Finn Balor get a push. Use the demon. Get him some gold around his waist. Give him the Universal Championship, man. Come on. Can you imagine the demon doing an entrance with a Universal Championship? How beautiful would that be? But anyways, guys, squash match, Demon Balor return. Thank God. Get my boys some gold, and this is going to be flames. Next, we had the United States Championship match between Shinsuke Nakamura taking on the Charismatic Enigma, my boy Jeff Hardy. It's a solid little matchup right here, you know, much better than Extreme Rules, where it was 8 seconds, low blow, game over. There was some good back and forth, great storytelling again with this matchup. So I enjoyed, you know, both guys trying to psych each other out with, you know, getting in their head, doing each other's taunts and mocking each other. I thought that was beautiful. And there were a lot of cool spots in this matchup. Good back and forth, as I said. At one point, Jeff went for the twist of fate. He missed. Shinsuke dropped to his knees, went for a low blow. Jeff evaded it. More mind games going on between them. At another point in the match, Shinsuke rolled out to the apron after he took a swanton bomb. He grabbed the ropes to kick out at two, and then he rolled onto the apron. Jeff Hardy tries to hit a swanton bomb on the apron. Shinsuke Nakamura moves out of the way, and Jeff Hardy just crashes into the apron. My God, guys, that rumor about him slowing down or trying to come to, you know, the end of his career or whatever it is about him trying to rest and not do epic moves is total BS, because he almost died doing that spot. Like, my back, I've had a fractured back. I know what back pain feels like, and I know for a fact that if that happened to me, I don't think I would be able to move. So Jeff Hardy is an absolute beast. But anyways, after that spot, Shinsuke rolled it back in the ring. Kinshasa, 1, 2, 3, and that was it. No Randall Keith Orton during the match, but we did have Randall Keith Orton after the match. So after the matchup, I thought for sure Randy Orton was going to get involved in this match. He did not. He came out after the bell, after Shinsuke's music was playing. Randy Orton came out. He got almost to the ring. He started charging towards the ring, and then it's like something came over him, and he said, nah, I'm not going to go. And he turned around and just walked off to no music. And I thought that was a weird little ending there. But Shinsuke Nakamura does retain the U.S. Championship, but not thanks to Randy Orton. Randy Orton had no part, and I'm interested to see where they go from here. Next was the Raw Women's Championship match between Alexa Bliss and Ronda Rousey. Guys, and this match pretty much went exactly how I thought it would go. I predicted Alexa Bliss to win, but only because I thought WWE would be a piece of S, you know, throw all these different curves. They love to swerve us and have interferences and ish. I don't know why Natalya came out first. I don't know what that was about. However, new Raw Women's Champion. That was pretty much it. I know this Ronda Rousey figure sucks, but you know what? We just have to deal with it until Mattel gives us one. Mattel, hurry up and give us a Ronda Rousey figure. But Ronda Rousey, new Women's Champion. New Raw Women's Champion. Thank God we got it off of Alexa Bliss, and now we can move forward with this, see where we go from here. I didn't like the Bella Twins getting in the ring, trying to steal the spotlight away from Ronda Rousey. I thought that was pretty lousy. That rhymed, unintentional. But Ronda Rousey, new Raw Women's Champion. Not much to this match, pretty much a squash, broke her arm. Yeah, Ronda Rousey. And for our main event, ladies and gentlemen, we had the Universal Championship rematch for the third time. Roman Reigns taking on Brock Lesnar. And this matchup was very unpredictable. You know, nobody knew what was going to happen going in. I literally had zero clue, guys. I mean, this thing could have went so many different ways. During the matchup, Braun Strowman came out, and he said, at the beginning of the match, he came out, he said, you know what, the winner of this match is going to get these hands. I'm going to face the winner face to face. And he sat outside the ring waiting. We had multiple Superman punches, German suplexes, spear after spear. Lesnar locked in the triangle choke a few times, and I was so, like, I did not know what was going to happen in this matchup. And near the middle of the matchup, Roman Reigns dove through the ropes, hit Braun Strowman. Brock Lesnar took that upon himself to pick up F5 Braun Strowman, hit him with the case, hit him with the chair, launched the Money in the Bank briefcase across the arena so that Braun could not cash in. Brock gets back in the ring, spear, and 1, 2, 3, we have a brand new Universal Champion, guys. The big dog did it. The big dog has finally done it. He is the new Universal Champion. He finally did it, and Braun Strowman could not cash in. I guess Brock just made it possible where he couldn't. So now we are faced with a cash-in tomorrow night. I guarantee you tomorrow night on Monday Night Raw or tonight, whether you're watching this the night of or the day of Monday Night Raw, Braun Strowman's going to cash in, and he's going to capture the Universal Championship, and then Roman Reigns is going to turn heel, because you can't have a face Roman against a over AF face Braun Strowman. It's just not going to happen. That's what's going to happen. Brock Lesnar is going to go off to the UFC. We're going to have a Universal Champion on Monday Night Raw every night, and it's all well with the universe. So, the big dog won, and that's pretty much all I have to say. I mean, it was entertaining for what it was. I didn't expect anything more. It was pretty insane, to be honest with you. I like the unpredictability of it. Nothing really happened with Paul Heyman, so I thought that was odd. But yeah, guys, that pretty much does it for your SummerSlam 2018 review. I enjoyed the show overall. I thought there were a lot of great moments in it. There were some moments, you know, that I didn't really care for. But as far as the entire show as a whole, I actually enjoyed the pay-per-view, and there were some good things on the show. I need to do some customs, and I need to show you guys those. I have a lot of stuff to get going on, but leave a like on this video, subscribe to the channel for more epic WWE figure videos. Comment down below if you enjoyed SummerSlam. I would love to know your thoughts. I can't wait to watch Monday and Tuesday to see what happens after, which always gives the sign of, you know, a solid pay-per-view if you can't wait for the next show. So that pretty much does it, guys. See you guys in the next video. Thank you.